The people who had lived at Paritutu were desperate to find out some sort of proof that their health problems were caused by emissions from the Ivan Watkinsdale plant. Finally, there was evidence they'd been poisoned. They had levels of dioxin in their blood on par with people in Vietnam. But the blood serum studies weren't finished. They were waiting to see the results of a second round of testing. So the people of Paritutu pinned their hopes on the blood serum tests they thought would supply the answers they were so desperately looking for. They were told they would be comprehensive. There would be 100 blood samples taken. But by the time testing came around, the sample group was reduced to just 52. And by now, it was 17 years after the plant had stopped making 245T. Why did it take so long to do the serum tests in Paritutu?
I think there was a mixture of things. Firstly, the recognition that there was a clear link between exposure to dioxin and some cancers was really only formalised in 97, and so that gave another burst, if you like, to the issue, and gave, you know, there was another reason to look again at the issue.
But the people in Paritutu, who are potentially one of the highest exposed groups, you know, the tests were recommended in 1986 by an environmental working party. The tests were
Dr. Mark Jacobs is New Zealand's Director of Public Health.
You tested sprayers in 1988. Nationwide serum tests of nearly 2,000 people were done in 1997, and still the people of Paritutu are waiting. Is it any wonder that the people down there have a saying about the Ministry of Health, and it is, they will delay and deny until you die?
I think it's entirely understandable that they're concerned about the delays, and as I say, I think it would have been much more preferable with the benefit
of
hindsight.
Why didn't it happen?
Yeah, I don't know, but I think part of it was because of the fact that there was still a lot of uncertainty around the science, you know, what the health implications were of exposure until the 97 identification. But with the benefit of hindsight, clearly the serum study should have happened earlier. It would have been much preferable for all sorts of reasons if it did.
Remember, round one of the serum tests showed Paritutu people had five times the dioxin levels of other New Zealanders. In round two, another 28 people were tested, making the final sample group 52.
If you have any questions afterwards, if you want to round interviews, please come in.
In March 2005, the Ministry of Health released what would be the full and final report. This time, using the correct national background average, the final results showed Paritutu residents, on average, had four times the dioxin levels of other New Zealanders.
It's a concern that people were exposed at those sorts of levels, there's no doubt about that, and we're certainly very sympathetic for the people that were exposed in a way that they had no control over.
But the New Plymouth Dioxin Group and some of the test participants believe the serum study is seriously flawed. They claim the data has been wrongly interpreted, and this downplays the degree of the dioxin contamination problem.
What I understand they're saying is we don't know what the hell happened.
So we hired an independent expert to see if these concerns are warranted.
I think they are, yes.
John Leonard, a forensic accountant, studied the data we obtained along with the government's own documentation.
Your figures are quite a lot different to their figures. Your figures show this.
Mm-hmm.
Their figures are more like this.
That's correct, yes. That's because they've got two people in the wrong place. Now, if you take that...
In brief, John Leonard found there were participants in the wrong group. Different data sets merged, a potential omission of a key participant, and lack of certainty because of the reduced sample size.
What I'm saying is there is enough information for me to have concerns about the accuracy of it.
How concerned are you about the accuracy of it?
Academically, it is concerning. And I guess for the people in Paritutu, it would be emotionally very concerning.
So you don't think the people of Paritutu have been well served by this study?
No, I don't think they have. My recommendation would be that somebody totally independent looks at this. The data is there. Why not let somebody else look at it? If it's accurate, then fine. I'm wrong. But if it's not accurate, then we will find out the correct position. It doesn't matter who's wrong. The vital thing here is the correct position for the people of Paritutu.
Yeah, and if you've got that advice, we want to see it. I mean, if there's issues around the methodology, we want to know. I mean, that was why...
Well, I'll tell you what, since October 2005, this has been sent to the Health and Disability Commissioner, the Minister of Health, the ESR study team, from people in the community. The issues have already been canvassed.
Well, I mean, I'm aware of issues like concerns being raised by different people in the community.
These exact issues have been raised by people in the community.
I mean, all we can do is go away and look again to see whether there's new issues that are being raised that haven't been dealt with previously.
We put to Dr. Jacobs the conclusion from our independent expert, John Leonard. His recommendations are that the serum study is reviewed with the raw data by an independent biostatistician, preferably someone offshore. Will you agree to this?
Well, certainly. In fact, we've already had the study and its methodology and its findings reviewed by a number of independent experts offshore.
Did they have the Appendix O? Did they have the raw data?
I think they got all of it, yes.
Well, I've asked them and they didn't. They didn't have Appendix O, which has got the anonymous serum results in it.
Well, I mean, my assumption is that they had received it. I mean,
we can
double check that. Well, I mean, I would have assumed that the independent reviewers would get access to the full report so they can, you know, they can make a considered judgment on whether there's issues with the methodology.
There's issues with the data.
Well,
that's what
I meant. It's included in the methodologies.
Any concerns over the serum studies could, of course, be clarified if the Ministry of Health were to release Appendix O, which contains the anonymous serum results. We have been asking for that document under the Official Information Act since March of this year.
We're still working through the appeal to the Ombudsman that you made to get access to
the anonymous.
Obviously, the Ombudsman and the Privacy Commissioner have looked at that. And so at the end of the day, after all of that process, if they indicate that, in fact, there aren't privacy concerns, then we'll release them.
Do you understand why people think there's just been one heck of a cover-up when it comes to dioxin, Paritutu, 245T, Ivan Watkinsdale?
Oh, I can absolutely understand the concern that it's been taking so long. There's been all these different studies that, you know, have they shown things, haven't they shown things?
What has been clearly shown is that the Paritutu community were exposed to high levels of dioxin. In order to identify the effects of this exposure, the recommendation was to do a health study on people who lived in Paritutu when the plant was in full 245T production mode. That would mean focusing on around 500 houses in Paritutu, approximately 2,000 people. Instead, the Ministry of Health carried out a cancer study of the entire New Plymouth Territorial Authority, approximately 60 to 66,000 people. Any problems, elevations in Paritutu would be lost.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right that if the issue was just about Paritutu, the ideal thing would have been to try and look at the cancer rates just in the people who'd been in that area, you know, a kilometre south, 400 metres east.
That was the Minister of Health briefing. The Minister of Health briefing was for any scientific study to be valid, you had to identify the exposed group and you had to track them and you had to trace them.
Yeah, and
that was in 2001. That still hasn't been done.
A lot of it was practical issues around trying to identify that group because the local sort of census area, the boundaries had changed and trying to identify the people. But also really another practical issue around these sort of epidemiological studies is at the end of the day, if the numbers aren't very big, they don't tell you anything. At the end of the day, the ministry and myself as a member of the ministry. I mean, if there's an issue there, we want to find it. I mean, it's not in anybody's interest. It's not in our interest to say there isn't an issue.
It doesn't look like you want to find it. Because if you look at this issue over decades, you've got medical officers of health saying, oh, those birth defects are an act of God. You had the director of public health saying you could drink 2,4,5-T. I mean, do you understand why affected people have felt that the health department has been more interested in protecting the New Zealand economy than protecting public health?
Oh, I can understand why people who've been exposed to something against their will are concerned about that, and they're concerned that, people aren't taking action that they think needs to happen.
To me, she wasn't dead, like, the whole time. You know, to me, she was just a normal baby, and, you know, I held her and stuff like a normal baby. But, yeah.
Coming up next, the families who believe they are living with the legacy of the agrochemicals 2,4,5-T and 2,4-D. Your daughter has just buried her baby.
Yeah.
So that's four generations.
Yeah.